Audible Inc. presents Stop Complainers and Energy Drainers, How to Negotiate Work Drama to Get More Done. Written by Linda Byars Swindling. Narrated by Linda Byars Swindling.
This book is for all the influencers who have invested their time, energy, and resources with me to help develop their potential and the potential of their people. Thank you for your trust and your experiences, and for allowing me to be part of your professional journey and breakthroughs. Journey on. Work Drama 101. Complainers are expensive. Is your company losing money because of constant complainers? Definitely. In today's economy, organizations expect the same or better results with fewer people to deliver. With jobs being downsized, right-sized, offshored, outsourced, and eliminated, the demand for more output and better results with fewer people has increased the workload and increased the stress. Complainers have fewer places to hide, and hardworking coworkers are showing less tolerance for those who complain versus contribute. At first glance, reading a book that complains about complainers appears counterproductive and an additional drain on your time and energy. Take another look. This book is designed to help you spot the type of complainer you have, understand some of the reasons behind the behavior, and gain practical solutions to address and resolve the situation. In this book, you'll see how to increase your ability to negotiate through the drama so that you can get back to work, and you'll have a chance to decide if you might be a complainer who is draining other people's energy. This material is supported by statistics, research, and expert opinion. Throughout the book, you'll find the results of a recent survey of 1,014 people who work in a wide variety of industries. The survey was conducted electronically over a four-month period and designed to collect data about an individual's past and present work experiences. People were given the option to take the survey anonymously. In addition to three questions regarding demographic information, 11 questions were a mix of open-ended, single-select, and multiple-select, multiple-choice responses, with an ability to provide optional comments. Respondents gave descriptions of complainers and examples of drains on their energy, as well as the amount of time they spent handling complaints, examples of complaints, days of the week people complained, and successful solutions. Participants were asked if they had left a job due to complainers, if they would take a promotion with a pay increase that involved working with a chronic complainer, and under what circumstances they could be a complainer. Survey responses are presented throughout the book in the form of graphs, actual quotes, descriptions, suggestions, and experiences woven into scenarios. Respondents revealed several surprises about complainers and how to stop them. Unless designated, the numbers and percentages you hear throughout this book are taken from this survey, and full results are found at stopcomplainers.com. The 10 business reasons to stop complainers are 1, the cost, 2, negative effect and loss of good employees, 3, legal ramifications, 4, environmental infection, 5, signal of mental illness, 6, your sanity, 7, business reputation, 8, complainers' potential, 9, counterproductive strategy, and 10, the right thing to do. Reason 1, the cost. 78% of people report a loss of at least 3 to 6 hours each week because of complainers. At a minimum, that translates to 150 to 300 hours, or almost 1 to 2 months spent every year for every person who spends time dealing with complainers and draining situations, rather than focusing on real work that produces results. 31% say they spend more than 6 hours per week, and 2% report more than 20 hours of their time consumed during their work week. This unproductive time costs companies at least $4,320 to $12,330 per year per employee. In a company with 100 employees, The figure equates to a weekly waste between $6,653 and $18,988, and a yearly waste of well over $330,000 to almost $1 million. That means that United States employees are spending at least a total of $10.1 billion on wasted time per week, and over $505 billion a year on complainers and draining situations. These numbers don't take into consideration retention, retraining, productivity, and knowledge management, or the unquantifiable number of customers, clients, and employees that complainers drive away from your business. This unproductive time costs companies around $4,300 to $12,300 per year per employee. In a company with 100 employees, this figure equates to a weekly waste between $6,600 and almost $19,000, and a yearly waste of $330,000 to $950,000. To determine how much complainers and energy drains could cost your organization in time wasted, go to stopcomplainers.com and use the Complainer Cost Calculator. Reason 2. Negative effect and loss of good employees. Employees don't want to work with complainers, even if you pay them. 73% of people say they would choose to stay in their current job at their current annual pay, rather than accepting a $10,000 pay raise if it requires working daily with a chronic complainer. If you don't address the work drama, you risk the loss of productive contributors. Complainers cause good employees to leave a company and jobs they like. At least 11% left a job because they couldn't stand working with a complainer. That means culture rates above salary as a key component in why people, especially good performers, stay in their jobs. Reason 3. Legal ramifications. Employers have a legal duty to provide a safe workplace that is free from illegal discrimination. They must also comply with federal, state, and local laws. Complainers create an illegal harassment situation in the workplace. Disregarding complaints about complainers puts a company at risk for judgments, liens, and legal fees totaling thousands of dollars. Expect to pay between $50,000 and $250,000 in legal fees and potential settlements for each legal claim an employee brings in court against the employer. This is according to Mimi Moore, who's a partner in the labor and employment section of Brian Cave, LLP. To further confuse matters, an employer might not be able to terminate an employee for complaining about work conditions, including posting on social media sites like Facebook or YouTube. If complainers gripe about their work conditions or employment conditions, and the company disciplines them, the complainers may have a suit under the National Labor Relations Act. Where complainers are concerned, seeking employment advice before you act is less draining on your energy and your financials. Reason 4. Environmental infection. Work environments are a delicate ecosystem, and chronic complainers infect their peers with their negativity and pessimism. Psychologist, author, and expert on organizational behavior, Dr. Mel Whitehurst, says workers suffering from mild to moderate depression and anxiety infect other workers with anxiety and depression, spreading throughout the organization like a communicable disease. Entire work groups and even whole organizations can be contaminated with depression and anxiety. Companies can't afford further employee disengagement. In fact, a September 2012 Gallup poll reports that 52% of employees are not engaged, and 18% are actively disengaged. How many more employees do you need to hire to make up the difference for that lack of productivity? Reason 5. Signal of problem or mental illness. Complaining may be a sign of a major change to personal, family, financial, or health status. It can also signal alcohol, drug, and substance abuse or mental illness. Dr. Mel Whitehurst also says, researchers rank depression and anxiety among the three top workplace problems for employers. People who are depressed and anxious are more prone to complaining. However, persistent complaining, unstable moods, and erratic behavior are signs of a more serious mental illness. According to the National Institute of Mental Health, about 1 in 4 adults suffer from a diagnosable mental disorder in a given year, and about 6% suffer from a serious mental illness. Many times, managers and peers are among the first to notice a change in behavior. Addressing the complaining behavior alerts an employee to a potential problem. These conversations can influence employees to seek help in the form of coaching, counseling, and or treatment so that they can function to the best of their ability on the job. Reason 6, your sanity. Complainers wear on you and your mental well-being. Their drama can become your drama. In a sense, complainers are crossing over into your lane of traffic instead of driving in their own. Instead of dealing with their own problems or moods, complainers want others to feel their pain, notice them, address their difficulties, or even complete their work. Working alongside a chronically negative complainer brings you down. It disrupts your life, and it isn't good for your health. Doing others' jobs or coping with their issues is exhausting. There is a fine line between being a sensitive colleague who encourages good performance and one who attempts to fix every bit of drama in others' lives. Many leaders feel guilty or overly responsible and say yes when they or their resources are overextended, says best-selling author and psychologist Dr. Townsend. When leaders accept responsibilities that aren't theirs, they inhibit autonomy and responsibility from their direct reports, and they do not help them grow. Clear boundaries helps this process. Reason 7, business reputation. Complainers can drive away your business. Customers talk. If they experience good customer service, they'll tell an average of 15 people. For bad customer service, plan on 24 others learning about it. These numbers increase dramatically if you have social media users. According to the 2012 American Express Global Customer Service Barometer, social media users talk more. Give them a good customer experience and they will tell an average of 42 people. Give them a bad customer experience and they will let an average of 53 people know. Reason 8, complainer's potential. Yep. You heard it right. If you manage them correctly, you can help channel some of your complainers into more productive activities. Once complainers learn better ways to communicate, handle stress, and be assertive, some of them may choose to transform into contributors. Executive coach, consultant Elaine Morris says, complaining is a symptom of helplessness, low power, and a victim-like mindset. Giving direct feedback and redirecting complainers can allow them to see their own attitude is the problem. If they choose, complainers can work on building their emotional intelligence, in particular self-awareness, confidence, assertiveness, and problem-solving. The potential to grow depends on their willingness, and many people take that leap. Reason 9. Counterproductive strategy. Constant complaining does not work. Complaining without offering solutions creates a negative environment and takes the focus off of solving problems. A benefit of having complainers communicate better and bring solutions is the wealth of ideas and innovation your company can tap into. If complainers choose to stop whining, criticizing, and creating work drama, their passion and energy can be redirected to problem solving and contributing to positive change. A seasoned journalist with more than 25 years of experience, Lori Allen says, reporters encounter a lot of mad, angry people who have complaints. But the people we take seriously are those who can channel frustrations into a positive solution and transform anger into a passion to affect change. Reason 10, the right thing to do. Leaders have an obligation to address behavior that isn't working. Your job as a leader is to give clear instructions, offer the proper tools, provide a safe workplace, define desired outcomes, monitor performance, provide feedback, and enforce company policies and standards. When you lead effectively, you remove one reason high performers leave. By holding people accountable for their work and professional behavior, you encourage people to solve the problems they can. Often, complainers will either elect to perform up to the standards or will self-select themselves out of the organization by quitting. In more than 20 years of negotiating employment situations as an attorney and a mediator, then later as a business consultant, one truth is clear. People want to contribute to the success of their organizations. To achieve results, they want to feel personally empowered to solve their own problems and enjoy their work environment. Leaders want to encourage employees to do their best work and experience personal growth. More than anything, people and the people who lead them want the drama at work to stop. Introduction. How to use this book with no complaints. Negotiate your way to success. Complainers are energy drainers who create messy, inconvenient work drama. The disruptions they cause involve negative emotions, illogical behavior, irritants, and interruptions to getting your job done. Here are some travel tips to help you negotiate your journey through this book with no complaints. How do you know you have a constant complainer? People are happier to see him or her leave for a vacation than return from one. This book is all about spotting problems and fixing them quickly. It helps you spot how your complainer is causing work drama so you can stop the behavior and get back to work. Complainers are found at all levels and in all industries. Whether the complainer is your boss, a peer, or one of your employees, you'll find examples, explanations of the behavior, conversation strategies, and suggestions to stop the complainer from generating additional problems. You'll see negotiation strategies for all stages of work drama, including approaching your leadership for support. The term negotiating is used intentionally throughout the book. Negotiating is a strategic and much stronger approach to stop work drama than managing, dealing with, or handling. It's no revelation that complaining is a common occurrence at workplaces. Like others, your top complainers are probably coworkers and team members, employees who report to you, clients or customers, your boss or people you report to, family members, or close friends. Complaint department. It's true. Benefits do result from constructive complaining. However, if you're listening to this book, it is more likely that you're experiencing venting, whining, and griping that isn't effective, but is downright annoying. Chronic complainers are self-absorbed. Their complaints aren't helpful. They create a hyper-focus on negative issues. Complainers aren't concerned with solutions or correcting a dangerous situation. They are focused on themselves. These self-focused agendas generate stress, tension, and depression, both in the workplace and at home. Chronic complainers suck the resources, time, energy, and joy out of work and life. Their top complaints are too much work to do, unclear direction or lack of feedback from leadership, and incompetent coworkers or boss. Complainers use whining, complaining, or offensive behavior to gain rewards and/or to avoid some type of pain. For many, their bad behavior has worked since childhood. In fact, chronic complainers are often compared to school bullies, spoiled toddlers, whiny children, sneaky adolescents, and sullen teenagers. Complainers are called many names. Which of these complainers sound familiar? Rachel is a whiner who works in her company's benefits department. This morning, she sighed and started griping to her boss, Bill. I'm tired of all these changes. No one asks for our opinion when they improve the technology around here. They don't ask if we need the upgrades, if we want them, or if they will help us. Well, these changes aren't helping me. I'm not going to use them. In fact, I'm just waiting for someone from the IT department to ask me for information about their benefits. I'm going to be just as helpful. Bill, her manager, shook his head. He thought, of course, Rachel wouldn't take the time to understand the latest upgrades to the system. She didn't learn the last ones. Rachel wastes far more time and energy griping than it would take her to learn the upgrades. To avoid hearing her whining, Bill reformats Rachel's work every day. He decides that doing the extra work is easier than listening to her constantly moaning and groaning. Chapter 1 explains what Bill can do to negotiate with a whiner employee like Rachel. Here's another example. Tim is Brandon's lead on the marketing launch and a controller. Tim is a bully and demanding. Brandon spent the past 2 days with no sleep, ensuring the research and visuals were ready for Tim's presentation tomorrow. Brandon went to bed an hour ago and was finally getting some rest. At 12:30 a.m., his phone rang. It was Tim on a speakerphone. "Hi, Brandon. It's Tim. I was worried about you. You're not answering your cell. We're up here working past midnight on this major launch, and you're at home sleeping. I guess we know who wants this launch to occur and who lets their teammates work through the night with no help. Well, sweet dreams." Brandon lay frozen for 15 minutes thinking through Tim's critical remarks and his options. Should he wait until the morning for Tim to cool off or call him back now? Could he stay alert enough to drive back to the office? Should he start looking for another job? Chapter 4 explains what Brandon can do to negotiate with a controller boss like Tim. Here's another one. Evelyn is Heidi's peer and a toxic. Most of Evelyn's peers believe she is pure evil and avoid doing any work with her. The sales vice president likes results and believes Evelyn produces them. In reality, Evelyn doesn't produce anything on her own but conflict. Evelyn is smart. She makes it difficult for others to protest about her because she complains about others' performance and work ethic first. And Evelyn is unpredictable. You never know which Evelyn will show up at work, the one who makes you feel special and takes you under her wing, or the one who's vindictive and stabs you in the back. Other employees who crossed Evelyn are no longer with the company. Today, Evelyn took credit for her peer Heidi's work. Evelyn hadn't originated the business or even helped move the client case forward. Evelyn has complained in the past about Heidi's performance and work ethic. Heidi's drained, depressed, and sick of Evelyn's manipulation, but Heidi desperately needs the job. Chapter 5 explains what Heidi can do to negotiate with a toxic peer like Evelyn. Decide on a direction. You have a choice in how to use this book to your benefit. For example, you can decide to go directly to the chapter that addresses your complainer's specific behavior to stop it. Different types of complainers use complaints very differently. You might be surprised what you uncover. You can look at your complainer's reactions, learn the reasons for his or her behavior, and decide the best strategy to negotiate a solution. There are other ways to use this book to prevent complaining. If you experience work drama from several sources, or if your complainer has several complaining traits, you may want to listen from the beginning to the end. Later, keep this recording as a reference manual or a roadmap for handling future work drama. Disclaimer, nothing herein remotely suggests that one of the ways to use this recording is to throw it at a complainer. Despite your frustration, bodily harm is not an acceptable strategy. To maximize your success, please take the free online assessment, Spot Your Complainer's Type, at spotcomplainers.com. Then listen through the rest of the introduction to understand the signs you will need to successfully negotiate work drama. Types of Complainers. First, spot your complainer's type with the assessment. One of the surprises of the research was identifying more than one kind of complainer. In fact, survey respondents identified 5 types of complainers. Each type of complaining has its own communication style, including tone, word choice, and accompanying behavior. The five types are seeking different outcomes, from empathy and attention to stability and control. This book gives you specific communication strategies to refocus each complainer type. You can identify the types of complainers by taking the free online assessment to spot your complainer's type. Then determine which of the five categories of chronic complainers you're facing. Whiners complain by showing disapproval, venting, or withdrawing. They're in chapter one. Complicators, who employ complaining tactics that frustrate, complicate, and create confusion, in chapter two. Prima donnas, who complain by seeking attention, gossiping, creating drama, and stirring up trouble, in chapter three. Controllers, who use a variety of aggressive complaints in their attempts to reach an outcome, to control situations, and to control people, in chapter four. And toxics are dangerous individuals who use complaints and misinformation to manipulate and poison the environment to further their self-absorbed agenda, in chapter five. Road signs to help you negotiate success. Just like you would have signs on any journey, there are some concepts and tools you'll find throughout the book to help you successfully negotiate your way. There are quotes and descriptions of complainers and energy-draining situations, which were provided by survey respondents. You'll also hear common reactions to help you spot each type and provide ideas of the reality or the reasoning behind their behavior. Identifying some complainers can be tricky. If all of the behaviors don't match, or if they adopt traits from other types, be prepared to attempt different strategies until you find solutions that work. Stop. These actions don't work to address your complainers or energy drainers. You'll also hear times that you should turn to management or human resources, HR, to ask for help. And you'll also hear strategies to show you how to turn the situation around and successfully negotiate work drama. There are also travel tips or summaries to help direct you as you move forward to get more work done. Communication strategies. Spotting the type of complainer you have is the first step. Communicating in a way that stops the negative behavior is the next. People negotiate with their complainers in several ways. Letting them vent. Listening and trying to solve their problems. Redirecting their focus or changing the subject. Keeping conversations professional. Avoiding them and screening phone calls. Ignoring them or leaving. Agreeing and joining in the complaining. Asking them to stop. Reporting them to leadership or writing them up. Other survey responses included getting angry, telling them that life isn't fair, or having no idea, coaching, mentoring, nothing seems to work. To increase the likelihood your complainer hears suggestions for improvement, approach conversations with objective feedback. Mixed with a genuine.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.